Good morning, everyone. My name is Amy Rogers, and I am a member here at the North Fork United Methodist Church. But more importantly, I am a child of God. The service will begin in just a few moments, but before it does, there's a few announcements and upcoming events that you should be aware of. The first is the backpacks. It's time to pack our backpacks. After the service today, we'll be preparing and packing backpacks with school supplies to be distributed to students heading back to school. So after the service is over, come on over to the gathering place and help us with the packing party. Next, I would like to remind you about PayPal. The North Fork United Methodist Church has a PayPal account, and you can use that to make donations or to give tithes and offerings. Don't know how PayPal works? Well, neither did I. But it's really easy and convenient if you're not around on Sunday mornings. Just go to our website, www.northforkumc.com, and click on the contact/donate tab. That's www.northforkumc.com. And click on the contact/donate tab right in the middle of the page and donate to our PayPal account. You can even use a credit card or a debit card if you don't have a PayPal account. It's really easy, just another way for us to keep supporting the ministries and the outreach we do here at North Fork. Each Wednesday afternoon at 4 p.m., the church building is open for the church to gather in prayer. We pray for the world, for our community, for our church, and for ourselves. Then we listen for God's answers. Everyone is invited to come down. Everyone, that means you too. Invite your family, invite your friends, your neighbors, the cashier at IGA, the fishmonger at Charlie's, the guy at the deli making your egg sandwich, and even your friends on Facebook. Apparently, people got the message last week because we had a good gathering this past Wednesday. Let's see if we can do even more. Our God is an awesome God. We're going to be singing about that later in the service. But anyway, Facebook. We're revitalizing our Facebook page presence. Pastor Ken's wife, Angela, is keeping our Facebook page up to date and adding new things daily. Please like our page. And every time you visit the church building, check in. As a matter of fact, if you haven't checked in on Facebook yet, go ahead and do that now. We'll wait. If you have any questions, please see Angela. If you don't know who Angela is, she's the one standing in the back, waving right now. But before I go, I just want to let everyone know that you can be an announcement reader person, or whatever it is we're going to call this that I just did. Just see Randy after the service, and he will be more than happy to set you up. I mean, seriously, he'll be really, really, really happy. In fact, like, very overjoyed. Well, that's all I have now, for now. Remember to check out our Facebook page and website note for notices and upcoming events throughout the week. The service will start shortly after the following video. This is a song called Human Nature by Brandon Heath. Inspired by the 2018 documentary, Three Identical Strangers, Heath latched onto the idea that humans were made for each other. In the documentary, these triplets were separated at birth, and the three of them always felt this burden, and they couldn't describe it. They just didn't realize that they were looking out for each other. They didn't realize that they belonged to each other and that they were missing each other. It sheds light on the human condition and how we're supposed to be connected. We're not supposed to be separated. With this in mind, Heath penned Human Nature, about humanity's interconnectedness. Heath then related this sentiment on how he understands Christianity. God sees our human nature, and it doesn't scare him. I believe that we were made by him, and he sees our wars. He sees our addictions. He sees our brokenness, our loneliness, our fear, and I don't feel it bewilders him. Here is Brandon Heath and Human Nature.
God's children, we are not hopeless with what he's building. We can be unfinished and still be his image and bringing the light to the land of the living. We're not God's problem, we are his children. So don't let nobody tell you otherwise. The truth is in your Father's eyes, and anything else is a lie. It's a lie, it's a lie, it's a lie. When the Savior meets human nature, somehow the world don't seem so empty anymore. When the Savior meets human nature, that's all we gotta do is open the door and say, come on. God's family, we're at the table like it's Thanksgiving. He's not mad, but he loves you madly. He see what you've done, but he can see what you will be. We're not God's problem, we are God's family. When the Savior meets human nature, somehow the world don't seem so. Mistaken. Being human means you're worthy of love, you're worthy of love. So don't let nobody tell you otherwise. The truth is in your Father's eyes, and anything else is a lie. It's a lie, it's a lie, it's a lie.
When the Savior meets human nature, somehow the world don't seem so empty anymore. When the human nature, that's all we gotta do is open the door and say, come on in, come on in, come on in. Say, come on in, come on in, come on in. Say, come on in, come on in, come on in. He's out there knocking, so let's open the door.
Some people only care about themselves. education.
Some people treat others poorly.
Do with anarchy. There's certain things that are right and there's certain things that are wrong. So don't believe what there's foolishness. Everybody.
Some people only care about being right. Some people don't seem worth the time. But the truth is, most people are just working to get by. Most people are terrified to reveal their scars. Most people are fighting an invisible battle.
Sir, we forgot a bag.
Most people are worth the effort because all people are created in the image of God.
Where's my pillow?
All people carry the glow of the divine. All people matter enough for God to become one of them. God thinks every person is worthy of love. Imagine if we did too. Let's be a church where everybody's welcome. Nobody's perfect. And anything is possible.
Thank you.
Good morning. It's great to see everybody here this morning. If you're not familiar with me, I'm Rusty Aykroyd. I'll be your worship leader this morning. Thank you for that, Paulo, and happy birthday.
Great to
Interesting story. Our first hymn this morning that was chosen is called Take Time to Be Holy. And yesterday I was in New Hampshire for a wedding. Beautiful venue, beautiful place on the hills of, on the mountainside. Beautiful, really enjoyed myself, lots of celebration. And yesterday morning, Randy texted me to see if I would lead us in worship today. And I said, surely, sure. It's about 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock in the morning. Thought that should give me some time to prep when I get home, because I had a later boat in the afternoon, but I thought I'd be able to get home in time, because I like to read the scripture, and I like to read the hymn, and you know, just get into the moment so I can be prepared for today's service. And so I got on the boat, and we got a good ferry ride home, and I got home, and I was pretty tired. I was thinking about 7 or 8 o'clock. I probably should, you know, think about getting off the bed. It's been a long day. And my wife Donna said to me, yeah, you have to get up early, right? I said, for what? Church is at 10. She says, don't you have to be at work at 6? I said, oh yeah, that's right, I have to be at work at 6. So I got up at 5, and by the way, I don't know how it happened, but the sun's not up at 5. And I walked out on my deck, and I let my dog out, and it was dark, but it was enough light I could see the bats flying around my backyard, and it was quiet and it was still, and I started to pray, and I asked for God to guide my thoughts and actions, because I have to do that every morning, because when Rusty takes over, it's not always good. And so I asked for the Lord to guide me in my thoughts and how I behave and who I might meet and how I might relay the message of salvation in one way or another to the people I come in contact with. And so I did. I took some time to be holy. And I took some time to just be quiet and listen for the voice of God. Because the world rushes on, as the hymn said. The world rushes on, and we have to make that effort. It's not like we can just be in it. I have to ask and take the time to be holy. And then I get to come here. I get to come here for an hour after rushing on this morning, early on, before the sun came up. And I get to come here and feel His holy presence in this space. Because you can surely feel His power and His grace. So why don't we begin this service with this great hymn, Take Time to Be Holy. You stand if you were able.
Thank you.
Amen. You can be seated. Again, I'm Rusty Aykroyd. Welcome to the North Fork United Methodist Church. It's a pleasure to have everybody here in this holy space this morning. Do we have any announcements? Debbie?
Yes. As a congregation, especially the choir, we would really love to thank Brandon. We have been a special blessing to all of us this summer. And thank you so much for the time. Secondly, but not least, today is a special birthday in this house. It's Paula's birthday. Yay. We all like to see you. Happy birthday.
Sue?
After the service today, in the dining hall, we will be packing school backpacks for the pantry. We'll be giving it out on Thursday, which is today. So if you'd like to help pack the backpacks, we have 20 of them. Okay. So all help is welcome.
Okay, backpacks.
And all the doors will be locked. So we know the will be
locked. Nobody can help.
Annie? We are in the midst of another pandemic. Any other announcements? Okay, if not, then we'll rise for the call to worship. We've come to worship God, who loved us before we were yet born, who knows us even better than we know ourselves, whose presence never leaves us, whose love is as it ever ceases. Nothing can separate our heart from the God who stands with wide open arms. This is our God. Let us worship together. I'm going to remain standing.
Powerful. lightning bolt where it should go. Oh,
thank you all so much for coming out, and I hope you'll go home and read your Bible. I always find it interesting, all the people who read the Bible so they can find answers, and just about every time in my life I've ever found an answer, if I went back and read the Bible, it would blow it out of the water. So I've given up trying to find answers in the Bible, and I'm learning to look in there for the weirdest character of all of them, and that would be God Almighty himself, who is a... bizarre from our whole point of view that someone could be so totally other and so completely by himself, and yet he could want us badly enough that he would become like us in order to help us become like him. And if you want a religion that makes sense, I suggest something other than Christianity. But if you want a religion that makes life, then I think this is the one. When he rolls up and sees the angels putting on the Ritz, he's thunder and his footsteps and lightning in his fist.
God is an awesome God.
And the Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. Wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom. Starless in the void of the night, he spoke into the darkness and created the light.
God is an awesome God.
and wrath be poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. What do we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom. Good. I think you can sing a little louder than that. Here we go again.
You may be seated. Oh my goodness. Holy cow. You have one job. And I think it's the mask. That's what it was. Accept this prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord God, you are an awesome God. To have created all of this, to put all the stars in the sky, surround us with the galaxies, populate this planet with all forms of life that are all interdependent. You're a God of relationship, and you show us in your creation how everything relies on everything else. And Lord, we are here this morning relying on your word to feed us, Lord. So we ask for your presence to be powerful here, for your spirit to enliven our spirits, so that the words we hear might bring edification to us, Lord, and give us that abundant life that you promised all. So a special blessing, Lord, on our gathering here, and may our words be your words, and all God's. And we pray this in the precious and loving name of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And all God's children said, amen, amen. And Rusty's going to do the scripture for us.
Is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto
scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Psalms, number 139, verses 13 through 18. For you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book, before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks. Thank you.
Would you please join me in the reading of the Prayer of Illumination? My God, you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Give me today a double portion of your spirit so that I might hear with understanding what you are saying to me today. Amen. For the last 2 weeks, I got self-conscious with the mask on and turned it off. For the last 2 weeks, we were discussing God. We were talking about how God is revealed in his creation, so we know there's a God, because all we have to do is look out at this marvelous creation of his, look up into the sky, and just be in awe about how all this is formed and how it all works together and how beautiful it is. And that's how we know there's a God. And then we discussed how we know God. We talked first how we know there is a God, then how we know God, how we know God personally, what his attributes are, right? And we talked about God's love for us, God's patience, God's care for us. So I want you to think of it this way. I'm rolling this out, and I want you to think of it like a play. Imagine that you're at a theater, all right? So the scene opens, and the stage is completely dark. And then all of a sudden, there's a bright light. And as that light comes, it starts to grow brighter. We see something happening off on the side. And then slowly, we see the earth being formed from nothing, from chaos. The earth is formed. And then the light continues to shine, and we see the oceans formed in the sky. And then the land is populated, and we see all this happening. And we know that there's a God creating all this. And we see the stars and the galaxies, and all of creation is brought into being. And we meet the first character of the play, God, that's just done all of this. And then in the second frame, we see God's himself revealed to us, his nature. So now this play is moving on, and we're going to meet new characters from this play. Can I get the first scripture? We're going right back to Genesis. I started this 2 weeks ago reading from Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God, and that was that light that created everything we saw on the stage. Now, God has been busy creating everything, and we come to the sixth day. Was it actually 24-hour days? Who knows? I wasn't there. God hasn't told me. I don't think it's important. I've been in Bible studies where it stops on the first day of Bible study because everybody's arguing, was it actually 6 days, 24-hour days, or was it 6 epochs, or was it, who knows? God created everything. That's what I know. Exactly how and when, I'll find out when I go to glory. Amen? Until then, I can wait. So now we're on the sixth day. And God said, let us, interesting, let us make mankind in our image. Stop here. How many of you have your Bibles open to Genesis 1, by the way? Excellent. The word mankind, now we know this was originally written in ancient Hebrew. Does anybody happen to know what the Hebrew word is for mankind? It's Adam. It's Adam, Adam. We always think of Adam, you know, the first man, right? But Adam is the Hebrew word for mankind. So God created mankind. He didn't create man first and woman second. That's the other creation story we'll get to next week. But this week, this is the first creation story. Wait, there's two creation stories? Yes, while you have your Bible open to this part, this is the first one. If you turn the page, you're going to see it starts over again when God is creating Adam and Eve. But it's important for you to understand that Adam, is mankind, includes all of us. So, let us make mankind in our image. Interesting, our, there's that plural, us and our. In our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky. So now I have another question for you. This is interactive, okay? You guys need to be thinking. And I need to be thinking. I'm not wearing a mask, so I'm going to go back here. You need to be thinking, what does it mean to be formed in God's image? You just saw, how many faces was that, 120? 200. You just saw 200 faces. None of them looked alike, did they? Different colors, men, women, facial hair, not tall. So if we all look different, What does God look like? What does that mean to be created in God's image? Well, this is apparent to you when you continue to read through the scriptures. God is what? God is a spiritual being. Amen? God's a spiritual being. He's not that image that Michelangelo painted on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. He's not an old man that hangs out in the clouds. That's us personifying God, making him into something we can understand. But God's beyond that. God is a spiritual being. So when he says we are created in his image, we are created as spiritual beings. Amen? So reading through this, God has created all the animals. God has created all the plants, all the fish in the sea. God has created everything. And then the pinnacle of his creation is you. Isn't that amazing? God stopped what he's doing and created all of us, Adam, mankind, in his image, meaning he gave us a spirit. So different from any other creature, we have a spirit. So if it was God's likeness was physical, you could say a gorilla is in God's likeness, right? It has two legs, two arms, five fingers, five toes, walks around on its feet, can stand upright, looks very much like us. It's close, but it doesn't say that, does it? It said God created Adam, mankind, in his image, meaning he gave us a spirit. And he gave us the spirit so our spirit can communicate with his spirit. Amen? We alone in creation communicate with God. We alone think that about a God or decide there is it. God's given us this incredible gift, not just our intellect, but our spirits. Amen? So, he gives it to us so that we might have dominion over his creation. It says, and the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created all of this, then created us in his image, gave us a spirit, and said, take care of this. Amen? This is for you. This is going to feed you. This is your playground. I created this for you. You need to take care of it. How are we doing? I'm one of these radical ecologists. I won't go into that now, but I think this is such an incredible gift. Part of it comes from being a Boy Scout and being out in this. You know, I want to maintain this exactly as it is. And then God blessed them. Could you roll back just one frame? So God created mankind in his own image. Again, Adam. In the image of God, he created them. Right? Male and female, he created them. So God created us in his image, male and female, and gave us each a spirit. Okay, now we can go to the next frame. And then God blessed them, the man and the woman, and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. So God creates us in his image, he gives us a spirit, and he gives us dominion over everything. And there we are in the Garden of Eden with all the food we could ever want, everything we could ever need. What could possibly go wrong? Well, we find out what goes wrong, and we're going to talk about that more next week. But we know what went wrong was we started to worship the creature rather than the creator. And there's another character that we're going to be introduced to next week. But let's go on to, we continue with this. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. Every green plant for food. So we were created as, right. We weren't to kill. Nothing was to die. We were just going to be eating vegetation, right? What could possibly go wrong? Now we'll go to the next slide. The next reading is from Psalms. Okay, this is a psalm from David. And this continues along the line of what we were just talking about God creating us. So God created mankind and paid special attention to you and I. And it continues to this day. Because here's David's psalm, song to God. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. God puts each of us together in a very specific way because of the plan that he has for your life. And if you walk in fulfillment of God's plan for your life, you have a purpose-filled life, you have an abundant life, you have a life full of meaning. And if you don't, you don't have those things. You have anxiety, you have doubt, you have worry, because you're on your own. You're not living the life that God created you to live. So David goes on. He says, I praise you because, go back, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I mean, think about us. I've been talking to some folks about something called neuroplasticity. I don't know how many of you are familiar with neuroplasticity. What it is God gives us such an incredible brain. We learn how to do things as we're children, and we take it for granted because we don't think about it. We can still do it. But then something happens, an injury, an illness, a surgery, and all of a sudden our ability to do what we did every day is taken away. In my case, I had a tumor, and when they took the tumor out, I lost my balance and hearing on one side, and all of a sudden I had very poor balance. And people were thinking I was drunk all the time, and they were only right part of the time. I'm kidding. Angelo, he says, stop saying that. But I struggled. And I all of a sudden my brain needed my eyes to let me know if I was on balance. And so because my eyes were doing that, I was bumping into things. I wasn't seeing things. It was so hard to explain. But because of neuroplasticity, your brain's ability to adapt that God gave us, I was able to retrain myself. And I don't think too many of you notice that I have this balance problem, right? Because I've worked on it, and my brain has relearned. So we're fearfully and wonderfully made, as David says. And he says, your works are wonderful. Look around, your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Even before he's a seed in his mother's womb, God has a plan for David. And it's the same for each one of us. The Creator God that we were just talking about in Genesis, that made us the pinnacle of his creation on that sixth day, is still at work with all of us. Amen? All of us. He made you something special, and he had a plan for you before you were even in your mother's womb. Next slide. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God's plan for your life was all laid out. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of the sand. When I awake, I'm still with you. And how many of you say a prayer or say good morning to God each morning when you wake up? Amen. I mean, for a lot of us, when we wake up, we say, thanks. That's another one. Thanks. And that's something we take for granted. So there's David's psalm. So again, I ask this rhetorical question. What could possibly go wrong? God created us the pinnacle of his creation, breathed into us his Holy Spirit, gave us a spirit. David talks about how incredible God has. He's still working with each and every one of you here today, made you especially the way you are to serve in his kingdom. What could possibly go wrong? Now we're going to pass forward to the New Testament. In this reading, Jesus is in Jerusalem, and there's a festival. And Jesus is already healing people. Jesus is, and you heard it in the video, Jesus is God incarnate. He came like us. He became like us so we could become like him. So now Jesus is here, and he's performing miracles. And everybody wants a piece of Jesus. and they all clamor after him. Now, while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover festival, so you know, Passover was once a year when everybody had to come to Jerusalem to worship at the temple. So it's Manhattan on steroids. So while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover festival, many people saw the signs that he was performing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. He did not need any testimony about mankind, Adam, for he knew what was in each person. What has happened? What has happened between Genesis and now Jesus coming back? Jesus part of God's plan. It says the people were attracted to Jesus because of what he did, but he knew what was in their hearts. Amen. Some people come to church, and I'm not sure what everybody's motive is for coming to church, but God knows exactly what your motive is, and it's what's in your heart that matters. And here we're reading very clearly, and this is a scripture. This whole bit that I just read for you is sandwiched in between two other things that are going on in the New Testament. So your first time through, you might breeze right through this and not think much of it. I did. But now we go back. This is very telling. Think if he's talking about all of us here today. All of us here today came and we believe in his name, but Jesus will not entrust himself to all of us because he knows what's in our hearts. And he doesn't need anybody to tell him what's in our hearts. Why? Because he's God. He's Jesus. He knows what's in our heart. And a lot of us, our hearts are not in the right place. Amen? Our hearts are given over to the world. Our hearts are given over to ourselves. And Jesus will not entrust himself to that person. What Jesus offers us is a new heart. Amen? How many of you heard of the machine gun pastor? I'll have to show this video someday. This guy was doing drugs when he was 12 years old. He was one of those kids that left out on the street. And his drug use increased, and then he became this behemoth of a man, and he ended up being a bodyguard for drug dealers. Then there was a shootout in a bar one day, and as he's crawling through, in the words of Johnny Cash, the mud, the blood, and the beer, as he's crawling through this, he's praying. He says, Lord, if you get me out of this, I'm going to give myself to you. Well, he was a heroin addict at that time, an enforcer for a drug gang. And he got out of it, and he gave his life to Jesus, and he became a pastor. And he goes to Africa, and he opens up orphanages in dangerous areas, and he stands there with the weapon. He knows how to use it. And he protects these kids, and he's called the machine gun pastor. And as he gives his incredible testimony about how God transformed his life, he loves to say this, and I loved hearing this. He says, I'll say this to 550, 500, 5,000 people. He says, how many of you want to give your heart to Jesus? So let me ask you, how many of you want to give your heart to Jesus? Any of you? And then he says, well, God doesn't want your heart. God doesn't want your heart. He's going to take that heart and throw it away. And he's going to give you a new heart. Amen? And he gives you a new heart so that you have a mind that sees clearly, so that Jesus can entrust himself to you. So what happened? What happened between when God created us and now what happened to Jesus? Let's go to the next reading, which is in Romans. Romans chapter 8, verses 5 through 11, and this is where the Apostle Paul, who also underwent an incredible transformation, which is a requirement for being a Christian, that you are transformed, changed, amen, go from being living in the flesh to living in the Spirit that God gave us. So Paul is now writing to a church that's having a little trouble in Rome because the people are different. Some are Jewish, some are Gentiles. And Paul explains all of this to us. He says, those who live according to the flesh, ignoring their spirit, have their minds set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. Amen? And that's as simple as it is. Remember, we're a three-part person. Just like a triune God, we're triune people. We have flesh, we have our soul, which is our id, our psyche, who we are, and we have our spirit. So who we are can either live by the Spirit or live by the flesh. And Paul explains, well, if you live according to the flesh, your mind is set on your flesh. And guess what? Your flesh is wearing out, and there's a clock ticking. And your flesh is going to expire. Some of us are feeling that already. Amen. But if you live according to the Spirit is eternal. If you live according to the Spirit, then you're feeding your spirit and you're growing and you're doing what the Spirit desires. And what the Spirit desires is mainly that we love each other. Amen? That we love God and we love each other. The mind, which is the psyche, the ego, right? The mind governed by the flesh is death. Wait, I'm not done. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. There's a bonus. The mind governed by the flesh is death, one thing. The mind governed by the Spirit is life, and you think it would end there, but now I throw in, and if you order today, no charge, shipped right to your house, peace. And isn't this what we want? I can't tell you, before I was transformed, I was just so angry all the time, twisted, upset. Things that people said, I just wanted some peace and I couldn't find it. Next slide. The mind governed by the flesh, your id, psyche, governed by what the flesh wants. I want to drink, I want to eat, I want to go out, I want to do whatever. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. And we read that all through scriptures. For we were once children of disobedience. We were children of wrath. We were God's enemy. Our flesh is a natural enemy to God because it's not our spirit. It says it does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. You don't submit because you can't submit because you're worshiping you. You're worshiping your flesh instead of God. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. Amen. But he goes on. You, however, and this I'm praying for all of you, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, which we learn in the beginning, he gives it to us, we just have to wake it up. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. Whose righteousness? Jesus' righteousness. Amen? Not ours. Nothing we do. So that's what it says. So Jesus did not give himself over to people because he knew people, right? He knew what was in their heart. Jesus will not give himself over to you because he knows what's in your heart until that day that you say with your mouth and believe in your heart that you are in a sinner in need of redemption and the only one that could bring that to you is Jesus, and you call on Jesus and make him the Lord of your life. That's when Jesus will send you the Holy Spirit and that Christ is living in you, and then you receive his righteousness, and now you can communicate directly with God. Why? Because of what Jesus did, not because of what any of us did. Amen? And that's God's free gift. Annie was talking about going to the library, and she said something, and I wanted to bring this up. How many times have you heard, especially now with COVID, hey, we're doing a virtual concert. Anybody can attend, but you must have a ticket. The tickets are free, but you must have the ticket to attend, amen? The library. Anybody can come, it's free, but you must register, right? So you have to do something. It's a free gift. You're going to get this, but you have to do something. And it's the same thing with our faith. God is saying, hey, you're all invited to heaven. I'll tell you what, today only, if you sign up today, heaven starts today. Your eternal life starts the day you turn yourself over to Christ. It's all ready for you, but you have to register. You have to have a ticket. So you have to do something, folks. And you have to, with your heart, ask for God to come into your life, amen, so that you're not in the realm of the flesh. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus, God, from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his spirit who lives in you. Amen? So what he's saying is, he said before, even though your body's going to die, your spirit will live forever because you're in Christ. Amen? But now he's adding, but guess what? When you are raised, you're going to be raised with a resurrection body. Say goodbye to this achy body. Say goodbye to this midriff. I'm getting a resurrection body. Amen? I'm getting a resurrection body that's going to heaven, and I'm going to look awesome. Angela, you're so lucky. But that's for all of us that are in Christ. Amen? Just as he raised Christ from the dead, he will raise us from the dead. Why? Because we live in Jesus, and Jesus lives in us. Jesus sits at the right hand of God. We sit at the right hand of God. We have a voice, an advocate that speaks to God for us. And everything that Jesus got, there's a human in heaven. His name is Jesus. Right? God created Adam. And Adam messed up. We'll talk about that. But then one man, just when one man messed everything up, one man made everything right. And then that man was raised in a resurrected body. The disciples saw it. And then he was sent it into heaven in the flesh. And he's waiting for us. John 14. Read John 14 this week. I go to prepare a place for you. I go ahead of you. And where I will bring you to me. Amen? And that's what we read at funerals. So in this production I was talking about, you've met some characters. You met the God that created the universe. We got to see who God is. And now we met us. And we get to see who we are. And here's something we discussed. And it says very clearly in the Bible. When you seek God, you know who you're going to discover? You. One thing I could say without fail, in studying the scriptures and giving my life over to God, I've learned God. I've learned about myself more so than ever in my first 40. I've learned the truth about why I do what I do, what motivates me, and it's given me incredible control over my life. While I was seeking God, I learned the truth about the world, why y'all do what you do, what motivates y'all, and it's helped me to navigate that. Seeking God has just opened up so many things for myself. So we met two important players. We met God, which means we met Jesus and the Holy Spirit, amen. And now we've met ourselves. Next week we're going to meet another important player. But for now, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for your word, Lord. We're grateful that you've shown us who you are. You've shown us that you existed, and you've shown us who you are, what your attributes are. And now, Lord, today we learn how you made us special. You created us, and you created us in your image by breathing your spirit into us. We have your spirit, the spirit of the creating God. Lord, I pray for everyone here to have their spirits enlivened. Wake up those spirits so that it cries out to you, Abba, Father, bring me home. Adopt me. Make me one of yours, Lord. Give me understanding of all things, Lord. I will seek you earnestly. I have a Bible, God, and I'm going to get into that Bible. Lord, I'm going to get into a Bible study. Lord, I'm going to get a devotional. I'm going to listen to sermons on TV and the radio and read essays, even though they're nowhere near as good as Pastor Bohler's. I'm going to do it anyway because I love you, Lord, and I want to know you. Lord, I pray that that's a prayer coming up to you from those in attendance today so that they might draw closer to you and you might give them the abundant life that you promised them through the mighty works of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, in whose name we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen.
I'm afraid my
Join me in this corporate prayer of confession, and I'll give you a moment to offer up your own prayers. Creator God, you created me in your image and have given me everything that I have needed. Yet my motive is often for myself and not to honor you, so you turn away. I live with my mind set on my desires, so desires govern my behavior, and I am unable to submit to your plan to give me an abundant life. Forgive me, Abba. I pray you clear my mind so I may benefit from your presence. Take this moment to offer up your own prayers. Now hear these words of assurance. Hear the good news. If Christ is in you, then even though you sin, God's Spirit forgives and gives you life because of his righteousness. With Christ, you are no longer in the realm of the flesh, but in the realm of the Spirit, and the Spirit will lead you away from the captivity of your passions. If you call Christ Jesus Lord, you are forgiven. And all God's children said, Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now our anthem. This is offering, and I just real quick, I want to add this in for the offering. What are you offering, right? We always think money, that's part of it. But God has given you everything, amen? And God's just asking for some of it back. So, and he wants you to give from your heart, not from a sense of obligation. So here's a quick little story. A mother brings her son to church. And they're sitting there, and the offering plate starts to go around, and she's giving the boy money, right? That's where the kids get their money. And he's supposed to drop it in the plate, but he's having trouble letting go of it. And his mother senses this, and he's probably thinking of something he wants to buy for himself. So she leans over, she goes, Son, put that money in the plate. It's tainted. Tainted, oh, drops it in the plate. And then they go around and finish the collection, and he leans over and says, Mama, why was that money tainted? Well, honey, it wasn't exactly tainted. It's just it taint yours, and it taint mine. But it's God, and you gave it back to him. So just that thought about offering. Everything that you have, God is asking you to offer it back, like today, helping with the packing of the backpacks. Amen? Time, money, talent, that's what God's asking for us. And now our anthem.
Thank you.
benediction. Go forth into the world knowing that you have been created, each one of you, individually with as much care as the rest of creation, and even more so that God created you in His image, every one of you, for a purpose to serve in His kingdom. So go forth this week as kingdom people and let everybody know that you belong to Christ, amen, until He brings us back together in His pleasure. God bless you all, and God be with you all this week, amen. You may be seated. Thank you.